Kickback, coke for coke till I comatose, then go float for flow while I go for throats, and I might go for broke till I overdose, but I catch my drift like Tokyo.
What's up everyone, this is the Australian Strongman Podcast, here with a very special guest today, the Slovenia's Strongest Man. He is a contender for World Strongest Man and the Arnold Classic. He's one of the strongest men on the planet, so it's MATJAZ BELSAK. How you doing, MATJAZ?
Hey, I'm very good. Thank you for the invite. I'm very happy to speak with you, and I hope we have a nice conversation.
Yeah, it's very great to have you on, mate. Anyway, I think everyone wants to know, first of all, how you're doing, because you've been, you've had an injury with your hip, and you've been playing your surgery and everything. How's that going?
Yeah, that's true. Already my injury started at 2018. It started to get worse. I had a dislocated hip when I was 12, so everything. I had sometimes a little bit pain, but not really something seriously. So I never think that's a problem in my joint. You know, I was just thinking, body's a little bit tired. You always feel, if you had an injury in the past, you always feel something was there, you know. I was thinking it's just dust, it's just that. But 2018, it just gets worse. And then I have some back problem. And my range of motion goes from like normal range of motion to less than 90% degrees, and then even less and less. So in a half year, I had a big drop of range of motion. And then I started to see the doctor, started to see some tests and everything. So all 2018 was already, didn't know exactly what it is, because I was still waiting some infos, and everything is going so slow, you know. So I was training around my pain a little bit. I was trying to do things that I can, but not so much things that were painful. Maybe it would be smarter to stop at that time and fix that. But the problem was the joint was in a bad movement already for more than 10 years, and it was some damage already done before I start even strongman. Because all tendons were overstretched, the joint was just not so fixed like it should be. So 2019, I think before Arnold's, I get the main infos from some doctors. And they say, actually, your hip is totally fucked up, you know. We cannot do arthroscopy. We cannot fix it just with some small surgery. You will need to have a full hip replacement, you know. So when they say that, I was all quite shocked, you know. I mean, shocked. I kind of think it's possible. But still, if you put the 10 years of your life and you just get an email, kind of they say, your hip is total shit. We cannot fix it with a small surgery. Just do strongman as long as you can, because anyway, you need to fix the hip. And after fixing the hip, it's not possible to compete on this level, they say. So I kind of did that. But the problem is I needed to take care more to don't injury in some other place, because there was just a big disbalance in my body, you know. The squat, the deadlift, the overhead press, everything was a little bit different. So what happened 2018 for Arnold Classic Europe, I tear my biceps, of course, because we had arm over arm. I was leaning everything on my right side, yep, to open the hip, and my right tendon, biceps tendon, just broke up. So I was leading, and we have the last event was frame pull. It was like a wooden frame, and we pull it on the concrete floor, and the moving was so strange. Sometimes it was quite okay, sometimes it was very, very, very hard. So the pressure what you put on the rope was not the same all the time. So on the last quarter on the race, I think I just feel something like a strong cramp, and I see the biceps, it doesn't pull totally up, so I was not sure what to do. And because I was leading the half of the crowd and people say, come on, go on, some say, oh, stop, and you don't know what you're doing. I was looking at the beaches, I tried to pull, but you're not really ready in your mind because it was so hard. If I would know that I already tore my biceps, I would keep pulling and maybe stay in the first place because I have some points ahead from Martin Litsis. But I was not sure. I was thinking maybe it just tearing my muscle, you know. So I was looking at the bike and it was still on the joint. It was not total pulled up. So I say, okay, maybe better to stop. And then I was lucky. I have enough points. I have enough points in the lead. So after not finishing the last event, I was still second, you know. Leeds beat me. And I think third was Jeff, maybe. I'm not sure now about that, but that would be possible. So yeah, I injured that. And yeah, and then everything goes on. And then I did the surgery. And then after the rest time over the winter, the hips goes even worse. And actually, when I was competing 219 for Arnold's, I even don't train any deadlift from the floor. You know, I always train plus 15 centimeters because if it was almost impossible to even train from floor, you know. So I kind of managed to win the competition.
Problem, isn't it?
Yeah, because there is just no range of motion. I couldn't squat down, so I couldn't go in the right position, and it was just awful to do things like that. But I think I can do better than 2019. If everything feels okay, yeah. I believe I can do better.
You can definitely do a lot better. I remember seeing you do like you're doing Atlas stones, and you got your leg out to the side. You know, it's such a disadvantage. You know, because this is at this level. You know, every little bit counts. If you haven't got your hip.
Yeah, that was not so smart. That's a stupid thing. But at that time, I just wanted to catch the last competition. I wanted to make some money because at that time, Strongman was one of my main income for money. And also, just my life was Strongman. You know, everything was, the last 10 years was so fixed to Strongman. So it was hard to walk away, you know, and it was for sure not the smartest thing. I'm not sure if my hip would be better if I would stop before or not. It's hard to say, you know, if you have some dislocation, the tendons not working like they should. Maybe if I would don't do strength training, maybe my hip would be even more problem even earlier. You know, it's hard to say, you know. On one side, that's possible if you don't strengthen your muscle. On the other side, heavy RBX and heavy lifting is also not maybe the best thing is if the joint is not on the how it should be. But it's always hard to speak for behind or for the back, you know.
And you got you're doing a log competition soon, right? In Russia, you said something about that before.
Yeah, tell us about that. Yes, Misha Shilyako just invited me for a competition. They do it with some organization. And it's actually soon. We travel there 18. I think the competition is 20 or 19. And then we're traveling back 2021. The problem for me now is just the leg drive is not there like it should be before. The core power is not the same because the hip. And it's very hard to clean from the floor. It depends how high will be the lock. I hope it will be not too low because then I fucked, you know, then maybe I do a zero. But I always finish my competition when I go there. I think I never stop a competition. So I will do the best out of it. I tell them I'm not in the good shape, but because it's so hard to get athletes right now, I say I come there, I want to support them, you know, they start a new thing. And it's good to have some faces that people know.
So yeah, how did you find out about Strongman? Being in Slovenia, it's you said before, it's not a very big scene over there. So how did you get the invite to the big shows? And do they still run Slovenia's Strongest Man?
Yes, we're still trying to do Slovenia's Strongest Man. We skipped it last year because I already started to speak with people, everything start to organize, but there in March everything goes down, so we skip that year. And for coming to your question back, I start to compete against Slovenia, then I go for powerlifting international, then I did a strongman competition in Slovenia, and then my first international was in Slovakia. That's like maybe 700 kilometers from here. I go with a friend. Then I do a lot of competition here around, so Slovakia, Austria, I did something in Serbia, so I started competing international around the country. And then in 2 years, I think, something like that, I was invited to Strongman Champions League, to FIBA, to Germany. And at the same time, I was invited to Strongman Champions League, Lithuania, because last year I win the amateurs, the Big Z amateurs, and I was actually invited. I win. Yes, exactly. And because I did good in FIBA already, I get some more Champions League that year. I was competing more in Austria, Slovakia, and here around with the small competitions. So that was going maybe for 1-2 years like this. After that, I was second place in Giants Life Hungary. So this was my qualification to World Strongest Man. I think Bergman was first with a really small lead. I think 1.5 points or something like that. I was second. Eddie Hall was third. So we three go to the Giants Life that year. After that, I was invited to Europe Strongest Man because I was competing in World Strongest Man. And then later I was competing Arnold Classic Europe. And then just I was on the scene, I was doing well. Okay. And I was just invited there. And then I qualified for Arnold 2017 when I win. I was competing in the finals. And then when you compete in the finals, they covered your flights and hotels for all shows around, and I again get enough points to compete in 2019 and so on.
So are you the only Slovenian that's been at Arnold's and World Strongest Man?
Yes, there were two good strong men. They were competing international, also Champions League, but I'm the first one who ever compete in the Arnold's and World Strongest Man.
So you're the strongest Slovenian in history?
Probably, yes.
That's awesome. Probably. That's really cool.
Thank you.
So you started lifting weights at 16 years old. Do you remember how strong you were back then?
Maybe even 15. When I start to go to middle school, I start to training a little bit with weights. But I'm not just at home, you know. I have my bench. I have a small rack and everything. I don't remember when I start, but I remember when I do my first powerlifting competition, that was at age of 17, I did 220 squat with easy knee reps. I did around, I zeroed the bench, but I was lifting around 135. I touched the rack or something like this. You know, one time I lift the S, one time I touched the rack, and one time I was too late, you know, on the first competition.
Just rookie errors,
Yeah, that was 135 kilos, I think, and I deadlifted on the fourth attempt 255 kilos with 17 years, and I think I had 117 kilos at that time.
So, did you have a defining moment in your career, like a time when you decided that you can go all the way and you're going to go for it as hard as you can?
I mean, for me, everything goes step for step, you know. I was not planning, you know, because I have no friends that are competing in World Strongest Man or Arnold Classic, and it was for me far away when I started with lifting weights, you know. Yeah. Even the scene here was not too big, so I started step for step. I like the sport, I have fun training and competing. It was like a big motivation for me to train to lift bigger and bigger weights every week or maybe with a time. So it was something I just enjoyed, and then the bigger competition just comes with time. And I was successful in a bigger one. I wanted even bigger, you know, and I win that. I wanted more, and everything just goes step for step, time for time, and it just come everything together. I mean, of course, when I was already competing, I wanted to come to Arnold's, the World Strongest Man, even a couple of years before I was there. But no, when I was starting, it was just, okay, it's there, mate, I would like to do. But I was not, when I was first competing in powerlifting, I don't say, oh, one day I will be World Strongest Man. I didn't have that in my mind. Maybe it's wrong, but just the true story how it was, you know.
And you were very young when you went to World Strongest Man as well, I think one of the youngest.
I think I was 21 or 22 when I first competed at the World Strongest Man.
21 years old, that's crazy.
22, I would say. No.
Wow. What do you think the future is going to be like for Strongman? Do you think the money will come?
I think the sport will get better with the time. I think that the corona will have a big, big effect in the sports, not just in Strongman, but in the big paid sport like football and everything and yeah. Soccer, because they have so like crazy amounts of money, it just will not be so crazy anymore after the corona, I believe so. And I think because Strongman didn't have so crazy amounts of money, it will increase with the time. The community is getting bigger, the training system is getting more seriously. Strength training is involved in all other sports. Strongman style of training can be involved in a lot of sports. I don't know, like MMA fighter can use that, you know, other people can use it. It's just getting bigger and bigger. The promotion is getting better. We have more companies that involving Strongman. We have more Alvus is new on the scene. Everything, they're making more promotion, they're making more with the TV, they're making more with the internet, and as more people are close to that sport, the bigger can get the prize money and everything with Strongman.
I hope you're around to reap those benefits, because you know you deserve it.
Yeah, it's a time, because now, you know, the problem was with strength sports was that just maybe the best couple guys can really live, had a good income, money income from sport, but not just because the prize money, because the sponsorships and because they own companies and products that they sell. But I think everybody who is competing professional, like maybe, let's say top 20 in the world, should have a good income from the sport, because when you invest so many time, effort and money in your sport, you should be covered like with a good job, minimum, like with a good job, because there is not just a time and not just time and money and everything involving you putting your body to something special, and you need to be paid much more. It's like to say, you know, a nice easy dance or somebody who is dancing easier sort of dance can compete or perform that sport for much longer than a MMA fighter. So the MMA fighter, if he can compete just three times less than other sports, then they should be paid three times more at least, because they cannot do as much money in the short time that other people that can compete for so much longer. And people should see that, and people should value that, you know, because you cannot be there and just competing 30 years in the strength sport. It's not possible.
You've lifted the odd Hagen stone, the timber frame and the Austrian yoke. Which one was the hardest event?
They're all a little bit special, I would say. The stone is just, it's just a special thing, because it's even not round, it's so difficult. If you don't grip it in the right position, it's just roll out of your hands, because the middle of the weight is not in the middle, you know, and you need to find the right diagonal to grab it. So the old Hogan stone is a special thing. And then when your head in your lap, you need to still clean it on your shoulder.
Yeah.
You also need to grip it right, you need to roll it right, everything. So it's a hard event. The big log lift is also special because it's so big, and the rolls on the end, the clean is so much harder, because the bigger the log, the bigger the handles away, the more lever you have on the body, and it's so much harder to push press it over the head, because it's the same when you see some weightlifter that they're doing log lift the first time, it's very hard for them, because when they do it with the bar, the center of the weight is just in the middle, and because the bar is maybe like 2 inches in the middle, it's so close to your body. And if you do it with a log, it's actually far away from you, and that's the big difference to a normal bar. The bigger that the log goes, the bigger is the clean, and also holding it like strict before you push press them. So, and also the frame, there's some crazy weights. I actually didn't do the big yoke with the 700 kilo or something they do, so yeah, I cannot really comment that. Yeah, I not can really not comment that, but it's just some crazy weight. I'm happy they changed a little bit the things in Arnold as well. They start to take care of the health of the athletes. They do the testing and everything. And they drop some, let's say, some cardio events for strongmen, you know, like last year, the stone with overhead and carry and loading.
Yeah.
I think somebody who can lift 200 over the head or push press, whatever, he should be able to do a loading or a strength event for like 75 seconds, you know?
Right.
Or maybe like the Wheel of Pain. It's an awful event for doing this, because it's the same movement. It's much harder than a loading, because you can run empty bag. It's a total different kind of cardio, if you can call that a cardio. Because people don't understand how somebody after 5-4 reps can be so out of breath, but when the weight of the implement is so close to your 1 mR, everything what's doing on the rep is very hard. Even one rep, if you focus, and because you need to activate your body, your core, everything, you put so much energy in that lift, can be already also take a lot of energy out of you. I sometimes, when I explain that to normal people, I try to give an example of the big cats, you know, like a lion or a leopard. When they're hunting an antelope, they're like sprinting for 20, 30 seconds, and they need actually rest after that for a couple hours, you know, yeah. Because it's so much adrenaline.
It's explosive.
They put so much energy in that, and it's not the time, it's just the increasing of the energy is so high from zero to high level that they get so tired after that. So
yeah,
a lot of people don't really understand it before they try it, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
How a log lift for 4 or 5 reps can be so hard or so difficult. Even people that have some okay conditioning, they do sport for fun, they do bicycling, and they are out of breath after a couple reps on the log lift, you know, because it's such
a different
movement. Yes, yeah. And it's the same around. If you're good in events and strongman, it doesn't mean you're good in cycling or whatever, but
exactly,
you should do more of different things, especially if you're doing sport on a hobby side, you know.
When you lifted the odd Hagen stone, I think you've shouldered it twice, right? One time it went across your back.
I shouldered it twice. One time it dropped on my back, and it was so hard to pick it up. I couldn't pick it up again. And then after that, for 2019, I already have this big problem with my hip. I was still training with a stone, but I always, the pickup in the training was so hard. I sometimes even did start a little bit higher. I put the lock mats on the floor, so I start plus 30 centimeters, and I just trained with a 145 kilo stone, because it was really hard on my body, and I didn't want to make some training injury for other events, you know, because when I was going really hard on that event, I couldn't do normally frame and yoke and other stuff and log lift. So I was training with a lighter stone, and it was quite like a challenge for me even do that stone. So when I lifted the stone 2019, I was super happy, you know. It was like, that's just not just like to lift the stone, but it was like, I would not say it a life goal, but a short-term life goal, you know, to prepare something and still to do it with your injury. I would compare it with somebody you know, who is preparing to maybe to start a new job and do an interview, and they call, and after that you get the job, you know.
Yeah.
You maybe take half year to prepare to everything, and then you just get that.
Yeah, you can tell when you lifted it the second time, it was a big accomplishment because you had it taken away from you. Then a year later, you come back and you got it, and yeah, you can see on your face you're stoked.
Yeah, that's great.
What is your favorite event, and what is your least favorite event?
Paul, I have a lot of favorite event. I would say dumbbell should be the best event, but I would not call like a favorite event, you know, because it's a dumbbell, you know. I mean, it's stupid to say like that, but I always like some loading, some medleys, some something, and it's also the favorite events change for me with the time. When I was good in something and train a little bit more, I have more fun with that. For the Europe's, I was training more axle. I hate axle training normally, but when it gets better, then it's better. I like some stones, maybe not even so super heavy stones, some middle heavy stones, because then it's also the agility and speed and explosiveness of the athlete. I like some overhead medleys. I still like the dumbbell, of course, because I'm so good on. And the event, what I really hate is the front hold or you know, this position. I was really, really bad in Champions League, always on that event. And the big minus about that was one of the main sponsors was a company for front hold. They do some cylinders. And almost every competition was this front hold, you know. And I was almost, when we were 14 athletes, I was always 11, 12, 13 place. And I always lose minimum.
Because you don't care about 10, that's why.
Yes, and I always lose minimum 10 points on that event. And sometimes I was really good. I was like top three even on the first, second year competing, you know. And then I lose 10 points on the front hold, and I drop on 5th place, you know. Next time I was almost leading front hold, I dropped 3rd place, you know. I train it, but it you can just not train it so fast, you know. With the time it goes better, and then I had some shoulder problem because I was not so strong enough for the front hold, and I still wanted to do it well, and the shoulder just gets worse and worse. So the front hold was for sure the worst and unfavored event for me. And I think if this front hold wouldn't be in Champions League, I would have like $10,000 more money gone. I'm sure about that.
I agree that that's a terrible event. And what's your max dumbbell? I think it was 140 you did?
I did 141 in training for Australia 2018 when I was preparing. But I pressed just 130 in the competition twice in Australia. And one time already a long time ago, I think I was just 22 or something like that in Austria. But I trained like a longer period for the dumbbell. The dumbbell in Australia, that's not my favorite dumbbell because it's so close. The weights are so close together. So when you drop it on the shoulder, I could not position the dumbbell like a one, because you cannot put your hand in the ankle because you need to have it straight, because I think it's just 15 centimeters between
the dumbbells we have here. So would you compare it to something like was it the seer dumbbell? So you think the seer dumbbell is a lot easier to press than the one you use in Australia?
I prefer a dumbbell like you have in Australia, just with a longer grip. So instead of 15 that you have, like, let's say 25 or something like this. So when you drop it on the shoulder, you can position your hand like you want, you know, because different athletes have different technique. And if you have it very close, you can maybe not use your technique. It's a great dumbbell. It's a very good production. It's very strong. They don't change, move, nothing when you drop it.
Yeah.
But I just don't like it for my style of lifting, you know.
Right.
And I think it's better to have a little bit wider. Then you can grip it how you want it, or you can have it close when the side of the dumbbell are round inside, you know. Then you can also position your hand like you want. I also had a problem. I speak also this week with the guy. The same when I had a problem with the lockout. I locked it out very fast, but because I didn't have my position, it always pulled the dumbbell somewhere. So I think 120, I pressed like three times to get a good lift.
Yep.
And the last 130, I think, it pulled my hands back. And because they're so close, it was hard to pull the hand out. And I almost tear my triceps tendon.
It looked like you almost did something bad there. You could tell the way it pulled
I actually didn't know that, but it was the same feeling when I tore my biceps the same year. So at that time, I know I was very close with the triceps as well. So because I couldn't pull it out, I already heard this, you know, when something is stretching, but it was not broke. So at least that.
So you think you can break the dumbbell record?
Oh,
141, man, that's close. Well, 9 kilos.
I first need to come back to the squad with an empty bar, you know. That's my goal for 2021, is to start to squatting with an empty bar. So after that, I can speak about bigger goals. I think anyway, if I can do 150, Mateusz can do 155. So, you know, that's like right. A crazy person. So I still have the two records for reps, 9 reps with 102 kilo and 14 reps with 92 or 94 kilo, something like that. So I still have a little bit of pride in the dumbbell, but the big
guy
is Mateusz with 150 kilo.
So anyone doing 140, 130, 140 and up is just, that's not even human. That's crazy. It's 300 pounds. Are there any old school events that you'd like to see back in Strongman? Anything that you used to do that you'd like to see brought back? And what are some events that you'd like to see get rid of in Strongman? Like the front hold.
Actually, I would say in Strongman that the competition should be put together, that you have these all specters of strength, you know? And after that, you can see what you can use. I mean, old lifts are okay, but a lot of old lifts that like this lockout or very high deadlift, they're just crazy of the body. Even now, the weights, when you can say now, the guys V or the guys pulling more from the floor than in a back time, they were pulling like over knee position for the deadlift, you know. And if you give the guys the opportunity to lift something super heavy just for the lockout, the possibility of an injury is so high, because the traps, the biceps, all these maybe smaller muscles are maybe not really happy to do something like that.
Because you're using leverage.
Yes, I think that some companies or some leagues, they do this and they try to use some tricks for the records that are not really a real records, and it can be really dangerous for the people, you know. And why do this if that's not really a proper strongman lift, you know? Of course, you can have some things sometimes, but I think we should not be too crazy about these records and just to try to find records. I mean, always when you're pushing the body, you can have some injuries, but when you do stooping things, you know, you're closer to the injury. It's the same with the training, you know. If you stick to the plan, the risk of injury is a little bit smaller when you do like crazy things in the training. And often that you try crazy things, the bigger gets the possibility to get injured. And sometimes an injury can mean that you maybe need to finish the things that you love to do. So some of the old school events are good. I think the old school events were also, what were fun to watch was the wrestling and stuff like that in the past. But I think it's not anymore a good thing to do. I think strongman should be not a contact sport, because the prize money, the athletes, they're getting paid better, and I think strongmen should not have some wrestling or something like that in the sport. I think when you want to do something similar, pole push is a good version of, if you can compare it with wrestling. I mean, it's not the same, but yeah, it's a little bit more direct, and it's still not a contact sport, you know.
Yep.
I think it's good that this go a little bit more professional and they don't drop events like this anymore. I think it's maybe it's fun to watch, but I think on the professional level they should not put this back. I like this some old school medleys where you have overheads and or some loading, or maybe some events that you have a carry and then some loading back. And I also like this natural stone and stuff like this, the objects that are not maybe in other sports. What I'm a little bit missing in the strongman community or strongman sport is that the events by the book should be a little bit more clear, you know. I would like to have, you know, if you have a log that you know how big is the log and how wide are the handles. I think that in the events that I produce it in the factory, we should have some standards. A lot of people say no, but that's the fun of the sport, that you have different things. I think the different things should be the objects that's out from nature, you know, stones, like wooden logs, I don't know, different plane, trucks, they're always different. But I think a log for professionals, okay, they can be the different length because that depends of the avenue and where you're competing. But I think the handles, the size of the log should be the same, or even have maybe three standards and then you can use what you want.
Yeah.
Also, I think, for example, the handles for the grip, because I'm not really a grip fan, I get better with the time, but because my hands are a lot smaller than of some other guys like Felix, I would prefer to have a handle on the frame in farmers, like it would be the same on every frame. So like in powerlifting, you know, when you see IPF, the Itingeleiko bar is 29, if I'm not wrong, 29 millimeters. Why you cannot use the same diameter of the handles of every professional competition? You know, then you know how to prepare, then for everyone is the same, you know. And now if you have a bigger handle, the guys with big hands, it's much easier. I mean, not easier, but they just have a better opportunity to grip the bar. And if I don't really believe that will change, but for example, like for World's Strongest Man, they have super small handles, maybe like 24 millimeters. Why would you have 24 millimeters? So many athletes always open their hands, and it's so often the first event in the finals, you know, and they already say them to change, but they don't do that, you know. It's just like a stupid thing. It's maybe, you know, like $300 to change that or whatever, maybe more, but you don't have 3 of 10 athletes already open their hands in the first event, you know. But for some of the league, that it's just a business, it's just a game, you know. Then I just competing with the injured hands, you know. It's more drama for the TV, man.
Yeah, yeah. I think it was World's Strongest Man 2018, maybe. They had the frame carry, the big red frame, and everyone was cutting their hands over. Everyone stopping, dropping the frame, looking at their hands because it's just getting torn up. First event.
Yeah, no, and also the frame, for example, have no grip. How is the grip in English? It's knurling. No knurling. Yeah. So it's good if the weather is cold, you know, and if it's, you know, sweating, then it's not a big difference with the knurling. But if you're in a fucking Malaysia or something like that, and you're already sweating that you can even not go for a walk out from the hotel, you really don't want a 24 millimeter handles and no knurling, and you're sweating like hell in your hands, you know. I'm not sure why how it is, but I think the small things they could change, you know.
So I think some general standards would be better for the sport in that way, and you can contest everyone equally.
For example, I trained very hard for the Arnold's 220 with the frame, you know, because that was the event that didn't affect so much with my hip, because the start is quite high on the frame, so that was good. And I did actually a personal record. I think in training I did, I would not lie, between 290 and 410 kilo for 11 meters. So that was even a longer course than in the finals from the Arnold. and my grip is a standard grip of 29 or 30 millimeters. So in the curling was nothing special, a normal curling, not too sharp. And I did quite well, I was happy with that. And then I come on the Arnold and the grip, I think there is 32 or 34 millimeters, you know. So it's just 3 millimeters, but when you go around the bar, that's 3 times more. So if you have a difference in 3 millimeters, it's almost 1 centimeter, even a little, almost 1 centimeter in around the bar. So it's a big difference when you grab the bar.
Yeah, huge difference, yeah. Yes. Especially when you have like short fingers, makes it a lot harder.
Yes. Just excuses, you know. If you're strong, you're strong. like Mateusz, he grabbed the frame and just ran, and after he said, "Oh, it's easy. I think I could walk for 40 meters with that," and everything was dropping the frame. No, it's just easy.
I think when you're lifting these huge weights, I think sometimes people forget just what it means to regular people. Like, people look at you and you're not like anyone they've ever seen before. You know, there's like a presence that you're almost superhuman. So what is that? What's driving you to be so strong?
I would not say superhuman. I think the biggest minus here is that people don't value the strength, you know. A lot of people think, okay, that's stupid, you know, why you should do that? You can lift that, you don't need to do that, you know, it's just you damaging your body. But if you're working like 15 hours, you are a businessman, you're also damaging your body and your brain, you know, and you have more money for that, maybe. Here you have something else, what you have with. And for example, it's the same with a marathon or something. Why? You also don't need to run 42 km. Why would you run if you can drive with a car? You know, it's the same.
Right.
But people just don't value that. I'm not sure why it's that. Maybe because a lot of people, they just go easy going. They're maybe too lazy. They don't. They also, how to say, they're not true, you know. Also, a lot of people say, oh, this guy have a nice big car. Why they need to show off with the car? You know, if you have money, of course you buy a car. If you just have it on the bank, then you don't need to work for it. You know, it's, I know, but some people don't understand that. I mean, the value of strength and the value of sport, it's something special. Of course, it's not something that you need to do. You need to live and you need to die, not much more. And the rest between is something that you put the energy in, and if you put so much energy in, it should be valued, but it's often not from the normal people. I don't know if it's wrong or if it's not wrong, but I know that it is wrong that they don't value the hard work of the sport, you know. I'm not sure if it's that because they don't can, or because they don't understand, or because they just in some other life, you know, and other energy level, you know. I don't know how to explain this.
It's human history, probably. You know. People remember who probably, the video, you know.
Yes, some of them. The 10 other strength athletes will remember me for life.
Oh,
no, but now with the time, it's getting better, you know, and I'm happy. Last time, for example, a friend of mine, I was wearing a jacket with my logo, and some old couple, maybe around 60, 70, they stopped him and he said, oh, can I have just a question? Is that the Belsak Strongman, Belsak Power? I have the logotype. Is that the Belsak MATJAZ, the Strongman? And he said, yes, you know. And it's really cool to see some other people, even, you know, older people, that they are understand, or they value at least a little bit of the strength life that some athletes have, you know. It's even more special if the older couple see that, or take that to a value.
Yeah, I think a lot of people value it. I think when you're at World Strongest Man, when you're at Arnold's, all those people there, you know, they're all in awe of you. So yeah,
because the communities, yes,
that's where it matters.
The people that like that together, yeah.
When you compete, how is your mental game? When you compete against the world's best, does that put you off? Do you get a bit psyched out, or you just don't care?
No, I was my mental game in the competing was always quite strong, you know. I I was always stronger on the competition than in the training. So I even know when I did not do so well in a training, I did know that I just try my best in the time when the whistle blow, and I can do much better than in training. I didn't know that. I did know that, and I was always stronger there. So I didn't really care so much about these things. Of course, I'm a person that I think a lot. I was like quite nervous before the competition, bad sleep, everything, because everything is in the head. But the mind game for the competition was really good, always good for me, or the most of the time. I also learned from the strongman a lot. Because a lot of athletes they fucked up maybe one event and they just lose the motivation, and it's just not something that should be done, because if you can make a mistake, the other guys can also make the mistake, and if you after the event you mistake and you do your best, you can maybe still win or do right. what you wanted to do. But if you give up, the chance is just gone. I think the chance is gone when the last athlete do his last race on the last event, you know, like Sedrunas. I don't remember which year it was. I think he was 4 points behind Brian, and he was winning the frame, and three guys go behind him, and because he was 4 points behind Brian, the all three guys needed to beat Brian to go in the time between, and just this happened, you know. And if Sedrunas would not give his best, he would just do a normal run, he could never win this Arnold, you know.
Yeah. Right, I think that's important to see it through, not just, you know, after one bad event, you know, so you got to keep it going. Yes.
And also a lot of time, you know, in the Champions League, in the end of season, a lot of guys were injured, not so powerful than on the start of the competition. So I say it a little bit in the joke, but it's a little bit true. You didn't need to be very good, you just needed to be less bad than others of the end of the season. Uh-huh. You know, to do a good competition.
Yeah, I think consistency is very important, you know.
Yes.
So, the World Strongest Man 2017, you did a last man standing stone over bar.
Yes.
Yeah, a lot of people said you were ripped off. What do you think about that?
You know, the World Strongest Man, all they have is some sheet with some event. With the last event, is it double points, or is it just the two guys go, or is it last man standing? The big minus for me was I should, because the first guy go direct in the finals, the last guy go direct home, so you have the fifth, the fourth, the third, and the second place. So the fourth place should start with the fifth place, and because the guy in our group was injured and the fourth guy didn't start with the fifth guy, the fourth guy started directly with me, and he was fresh. So I didn't have really a plus side of being third place in front of fourth place, because we start on the same level, you know. So after doing this 11 reps with him, I did 11 reps more with JF, and after that I see JF is still fresh, and I would not say I give up. I could do a couple more, but I just see JF is still going on, and I just give him the, not give him, but I respect that he was a better guy on that day. Anyway, he did better in the group, so he deserved the finals more than me. I give him half a high five, and he stopped doing the stone or anything. That was actually one of the biggest muscle soreness I had after that event, you know.
I can
that,
imagine.
How everything can be painful after a stone lever. I didn't know that before, you know, the quads, the glutes, the lower back, the traps, the biceps, the forearm. Everything was just really, really intense for the next 3 days for me.
Yeah, delayed onset muscle soreness. Eddie versus Hafthor, who do you think is gonna win?
I mean, they have still, I think it's September or one they're competing, or October. It's still half year. But for what I'm seeing now on YouTube, Eddie is much better fighter. He's much better in boxing. He's much better in his skills. He's faster. I would say he's probably a lot stronger right now. It doesn't really mean anything in boxing because they're both strong enough. But I believe Haftar is a little bit bigger hands, so he could use that. But right now, I think Eddie's looks much better in the fighting scene than Haftar. I think it's hard to say what will come on the day, how they compete, what they do. Now, I would say that Eddie have much better chances.
Yeah, I'd agree. I think Eddie's going to smash him. You know the two of them, you know, you've met them both in person, like their personalities, you know, so I don't know them, but just looking at Eddie, he seems like he's just a tougher guy mentally than Haftar.
You know, they're both great fighters. I mean, mentally great athletes. But I think Eddie is a little bit more, like one-man band, you know? If he has something in his mind, he will research things on his own. He will train. He will focus on that. He will do a lot of things, and he knows exactly what he's doing. I think I didn't want to be mean or something like that, but I think Haftar always have, when he was in the good days, always have a team around himself. You know, he have a strength coach, he have people to help him. Both guys have people to help him, but I think Haftar had a little bit more of that, and he's a little bit more, he need a little bit more help from others. So I think Eddie is better here. He can. And Eddie was doing boxing already for his cardio in the past time, you know. Yeah. So it's hard to say, because in the fighting sport, you can get hit what time, and if they hit you right, it just can be a KO, you know. Anyway, right. The referee stopped the match as soon as they see you're not well anymore. So just one right hit on the head or in the bottom can make a different thing. But I would say if they fight 10 times, that Eddie wins 7 times and half, or maybe Eddie even 8 times and half to 2 times, you know, but maybe this one fight can be just these 2 times from the 10 times.
You see, that's the thing with fighting. It's like, you know, anything can happen, but if in strongman, if you're stronger than someone, you're just stronger than them every day of the week, you know?
Yes.
But with fighting, you never know what's going to happen. How do you get so stronger at things like log press and deadlifts? They take a long time to build as opposed to events like Jochen Farmers. Yeah, why does it take so long to get good at deadlifts and overheads?
For the overhead things, I just increase a lot of my technique and the leg drive, you know? Because when I started competing in strongman, my strict press was one of the worst things. So I really take care to increase, to do my technique better. And I actually, when I did the first 200 log lift, my strict log was crazy, just 145, 150 kilo. So I gave 50 kilo out from the leg drive.
Wow.
The same with the dumbbell. You can have one of the strongest strongmen in the world, and they would never press maybe like Mateusz. He's strong in the strict press, but far as strong as Eddie, you know. But Eddie cannot come close with the dumbbell to him. You know? It's just the right position. It's. I think the dumbbell is the closest to weightlifting if you want to compare it like this.
Yeah, it's explosive.
Not with the technique directly, but it's such a special lift. If you want to do a big lift, you need to squat jerk it, or you need to side jerk it. You just need to catch the hand, the dumbbell on the straight and extended hand. If you do okay, if you do for reps, you can still lock out the rest with the triceps. But if you do for max, you cannot lock out the last 10 centimeters with 140 kilo dumbbell.
I agree. With dumbbell, you have to snap it. There's no driving up. You got to do it that one motion. Yes. Otherwise, you don't get it.
Especially for the max lifts.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, the best for overhead, I would say, strength to strict press, improve your technique, and improve your leg drive. So the three things will get to a better push press or the better overhead. And for the deadlift, it takes time. You need to increase your core stability very good. You need to increase your glutes, your hamstring, and just have a proper training for deadlifting that fits you, and just be patient. Don't change your training program all the time, because if something is working, you need to stick to. You need to be a little bit patient and with the time, you know, because 1 month is nothing, 3 months is a little bit different. But if you want to get really strong, you need to maybe 2-3 years of training, you know. That's something special about strength training. You can be as rich as you want, but you cannot buy the strength, you know.
Right,
you can buy you can buy some steroids, but that's it. The rest you need to do yourself.
It takes time. It takes a long time.
Yes, it takes time. Yes.
Are you a big believer in bench pressing for overhead strength?
No. When I was competing, of course, when I started, I was doing power bench because of powerlifting as well. And later I did that less, because when I do more bench press, my lats are much more stiff, so it's harder to lock out the lock or the dumb, not the dumbbell, the lock or the axle or the bar. So if I don't do that, it's a little bit better. The bench press is good, strengthen the triceps, but the chest doesn't really help for the overhead, you know. And now I was training a bit more bench press in the winter now, and I already again injured my pec. I think my body is just not happy with bench pressing, you know. I can do some closer or middle grip bench, that's okay, because it's more triceps. But when I do like wide competition hold for a powerlifting, it's more stress on your pectoralis, and I just feel very stiff there. So it's so close to get some injury, and I pop it a little bit. So I'm now back to lifting normally with that. But if you don't compete in bench press, it doesn't make any difference what the grip is. I think it's better to grip it a little bit more narrow, so your triceps go better. But if I would choose as a press, I would say maybe incline bench press can improve your overhead, and for sure strict press.
What are some accessories that people should stay away from, and what exercises have you found to be successful for getting stronger?
I think a lot of accessories are good if they do in the correct way, correct technique, and in the right amount of volume and weight, you know. A lot of people do then some different things, and they put a lot of weight, and it from the real exercise, it just gets something totally different. That's not even the exercise that they should do. So I think it's very, very, very important to do all basic lifts, and then to see where you're weak, to do a little bit more that, to strengthen your core, to do some extra lifts also to make sure your joints are healthy. You know, you have some patella pain, you need to do some different stuff. If you have some other knee pain, you need to maybe see that you stretch something or do more. You know, because it's always different. People have knee pain, and some have stiffened quads, some have stiffened glutes, and it's not the same thing. If you give them more leg curls, they can have even more problem. But for me, if I had patella tendon pain in the past, if I tighten my glutes and stretch my glutes, I did feel better after training. So often when I have the patella tendon, I actually stretch my glutes and I tighten my glutes, and I feel better. But it depends where the problem is coming from, because often when you have some pain, it's just that the muscle pull the tendons in one way, and you need to find which side is pulling and which side is maybe weaker, you know. Then you can stretch the pulling side and strengthen the weaker side.
So you've been a home trainer, you like coach yourself and...
Yeah, I did. So I train also the most of the time at my home. I was in the between time, I was in 2-3 gyms, but then I go back home. And actually I appreciate more to train at my place, because you can make everything how you want, you know. Strongman and powerlifting training is noisy as well.
Yeah.
So you don't bore other people. You can you can buy your equipment and you have, when you take care of that, you can have it for a very long time. I invest some money with a lake or rope and some good equipment, some custom made dumbbells, so on. And if you take care of that, you can have it actually for all your lifetime, you know. But for the start, I just train powerlifting and strongman together. We have, when I start to training strongman, they have a place, they have like a huge place under a shopping center. It was like a parking, but it was not total closed, but half closed. So that there was a great place for training, but we had that, or they had that just for 1 year, maybe maximum 2 years. And then somebody buoyed the place and they need to go out. Some strongmen stopped competing and so everything slowly fall apart. I buy some equipment, some old equipment for other guys. Some equipment I get from a friend. So I have actually everything. But in the past time, I didn't have really a good place to train outside. So I trained outside because my parents have a restaurant. So I trained outside when the restaurant was closed. But the problem is I needed to put everything on the tractor, you know, frame, farmers, yoke, tires, and bring it to the parking place. And then after training, clean everything, you know, put everything back.
I do the exact same thing. Because I train at home and I have a little small garage. So when I have to do things like yoke and stuff like that, I actually have to chuck it all into a truck, take it to the car park, do my training, and then bring it all the way back. And it's a big hassle.
I just wanted to say I train like that. And for starting events, it was good. I had like 5 meters and 5 meters, so 25 square meters, like a gym, like 2 shipping containers insulated as well with air conditioning. So for starting events, everything was great. Just for moving events in the summer, I did it like this. And in the winter, I just bring some of my equipment in the CrossFit gym and train there. But that is also a problem. They have a lot of classes, you know, and people are just stupid. You know, I always check them. Okay, they do a set, I take care, I don't go when they do a set, you know. But when they have a break, I want to go. And I want to go and they're sitting on my, you know, I go with 400. You just want to go with a video who are already running. And somebody just sit down on your, you know, on your 20 meter course, you know, just look around what you're doing.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Great, because I need to start doing my lunch.
Yeah, I was thinking it's been like 2 hours now. You got to eat, man. So hopefully we see you back in Strongman very shortly. You're 28 years old, so you're just getting to your, you know, to your prime. I think around 30, 35 is when you get your man strength. So you got plenty of years ahead of you.
I for sure will try or want to come back. I need to see how my body feels and I want to be involved in strongman, if not as a competitor, so often maybe as a referee or maybe something else. I'm working on that as well, like a coach also. I want to see forward in that, but I don't want to think that I need to stop to lifting. I will try my best, but I don't want to be too stupid to do something to my body. As soon as I fix it, I will work hard on recovery, and then when my body feels good, I believe at 222 I can do some competition already. Maybe already 221, some smaller one in Slovenia. Let's see.
It'll be good, and hopefully go to the Arnold World Series. I want to go compete there, so hopefully I can compete with you one day. That'd be
great.
That'd be awesome.
Perfect, a deal. That's a deal. Yeah, just drop me a message if you're somewhere there. I also, and we can meet for some food or a drink.
That'd be awesome.
Probably a food. Thank you very much for the invite.
Thank you for your time. Thank you very much. All the best with your recovery, everything. Let's hope you see you back strong.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, MATJAZ. На свидание.
На свидание. Hey, ciao.
See you, mate.